Amen. Let the church say amen. Come on, stand on your feet and give God a great big hand praise. This is the day that the Lord hath made. We're going to rejoice and be glad in it. The psalmist said, I was so glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord, for something happens in the house of the Lord. As you bow your heads in a word of thanks unto God, we are grateful to see you today to worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. The psalmist said in the 90th, in the 100th psalm, I was so glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. It's a little bit loud. You can turn the main down just a bit. Let us go into the house of the Lord, because something happens here in the house of the Lord. So we're grateful to God for you to be here. Now, you ought not to worry about the people who are around you and what they're thinking or doing, but rather this is about a relationship between you and God. And so I hope that you can let some of the things ride in your life, and that you can move beyond some things so that you can be like those Greeks who came to Jesus by way of his disciples and said, sir, we would see Jesus. And that's who we want to see today. Jesus. Say Jesus. Say Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus. We want to see Jesus today. Eternal God, our Father, we thank you for this moment that you have allowed us to come into this house and to worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you for your spirit that is with us even right now. We know that if we trust in you in all of our ways and consider you, you will direct our worship experience today. God, we thank you for these marvelous singers, these marvelous psalmists, these marvelous praise worshipers who are here today. Get all into their spirit, in their body, their mind, and we pray that that kind of a spirit will carry on into the congregation. God, if there's someone here today who do not know you in the free pardon of their sin, we pray that you will speak to them, that you will rattle them up, that you will shake them up until they say that I want to be saved today. We thank you for the worshipers and for bringing us seven more days from last Sunday. We are so grateful to you, God, even now. Now, God, help us to let go and let you. In Jesus' name we pray. And all the people of God shouted, amen. Give your neighbor a great big wave offering and tell them how glad you are to see them. And let's join this marvelous, marvelous group of worshipers even now. Oh, he's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. We shall praise him forever.
King of Kings, you are. Lord of Lords, you are. King of Kings, you are.
Come on, let's everybody say that. God needs to hear that.
Lord of Lords, you are.
King of Kings, you are.
Lord of Lords, you are.
Lord of Lords, you are.
King of Kings, you are. Lord of Lords, you are. King of Kings,
if he's your king, say it.
Lord of Lords, you are. King of Kings, you are. Lord of Lords, you are.
All hail the power of Jesus, reign forever. Let angels prostrate, fall, and crown him Lord of all. Ruler and the King, master of everything. Let's join with the angels, sing.
King of Kings, you are.
believe he will reign forever, rule forever,
yes, he will.
And ever.
He's our King of Kings.
Oh, yes.
And our Lord of Lords. We're going to lift him today.
After this,
there will be victory.
There will be victory after.
Lord. Come on, stand on your feet. What a marvelous, marvelous song. After this, how many of you had any pains or troubles lately? How many of you have had some issues in your life lately? How many of you had to worry about something last week? Let me see your hands. Well, there's going to come a time when you'll never have to worry again. The Bible says that one day we're going to be in a place where there is no sickness, no cancer, no disease, no high blood pressure, no diabetes, no doctors, no hospitals. Come on, somebody, you need to thank God. And God is going to give you a new body. A body that doesn't ever get tired, so it doesn't need any sleep. A body that doesn't ever pain again, that is going to be a perfect body. But it's coming after this. A place where you don't have these political arguments. A place where Jesus and God the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit rules day in day, because there is no night in heaven. It's a party up there. My mother has passed on. My daddy has passed on. But they're in a place where they're just happy, joyful. They're with family members. They're with friends. They are so busy laughing and having a good time that they don't even remember them being down here on earth with the bad times. And so when that choir says, after this, some good things are going to happen. Whatever you're worried about today, the Bible says, be anxious for nothing. Don't worry about anything, because at the end of the day, you have someone inside of you, and it's the Spirit of God. Have I got a witness? Come on, you can do better than that. The Bible says, weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning. Whatever you're going through, there's a presence that is so close to you. The presence is inside of you. I don't know about you, but the songwriter was right. He walks with me. He talks with me. He tells me that I am his own. I come to the garden alone. Early in the morning when the dew is still on the roses. But as he walked with Adam and Eve in the cool of the day and in the cool of the evening, mornings, he's walking with us right now. You know, we had three great events last week. I wish some of you could have been here on Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Now watch this. On Thursday, we had the city of Oakwood here, and folk were here that ain't never been inside of the church. The place was probably 1,000 people in here on Friday. On Thursday. On Friday, there's a little softer. On Friday, there was another jazz concert. These are all healthy music. When I talk about jazz is pretty good. How many of y'all know about jazz? Well, wow, you wasn't here Friday? Boy, it was the best jazz concert. The person who was in charge playing all that jazz was one of the person who was playing for Prince, I believe. How many of y'all remember Prince? Let me see your hand. Purple Rain, very softly. Purple Rain, Purple Rain. Amen. And that was jazz on Friday. And then they had a beautiful play on Saturday. Had about 500, 600, 700 people in here on Saturday. And I told Lord, I said, Lord, there's something strange about this church. He said, what's going on? I said, there's a humor, a laughing spirit that I feel. People were just laughing and enjoying each other. And I said to myself, that's the way heaven's going to be. We're going to be laughing. We're going to have joy. So we need to have some practice down here. Say practice. Just turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, you need to do some practice down here. Say, neighbor, on Sunday morning, it's time to leave your problems at the door and come on in here and have a good time. Why don't you come down to the altar for you? We're praying We're praying for you today. God is able to do exceedingly above all that we ask or think. Come on down to the altar. We're praying for our own minister, Lisa Evans, who lost her brother, Joey, a good long-term member and friend of ours. Also, one of our members, her child is missing. And so we're praying for her. What's the child's name there, Larry? Sandra. Constance. What's the... Who? Oh, Tonson. Yeah. And they don't believe that she's being harmed. She's just away. They believe that she's safe. She knows where she's at, but she's just not telling folk where she's at. You know how we get sometimes. I wrote in my book, I ran away two times. And I went into the woods around the corner, but when it got dark and I started hearing strange noise, I came on back home. Say hallelujah, somebody. My brother left the camp that I built, and when it got dark, he said, I'm out of here, Larry. I'll check with you later. I said, I ain't never going back home again. And shoot, it got dark, and I got out of there and left everything I brought down there, dishes, tablecloth, forks, knives, food. I left everything. Then another time I ran away and I got lost. I didn't mean to get lost, but I got lost. And God told me, said, look up at that bridge. And I looked up at that bridge and I told my brother, we were both lost. I said, let's go and get on that bridge. And I went up that bridge and found my way back home. Sometimes you just got to find the right bridge. And so I want you to bow your heads right now and just whisper a word of prayer for Tonson and this mother. And I want you to pray that she will make contact with her family. We believe she's safe. We believe she's fine. The family believes that also. But I want you to pray for that young teenage girl, that she might come back home and comfort her family by saying, okay, I'm away, but I'm fine. At least call in on that. God, we're believing right now that little Tonson, that little girl will call her family and let them know that she is fine and that you're taking care of her even in whatever she's going through. I also pray for Lisa, the minister here at this church, who's going through a time of bereavement, and I'm believing that you can wipe away all tear-stained eyes. Remind her what she preached about so many times. Now she must put it into action for herself and her family. And also we're praying for Sister Sandra, whose mother, Martha Johnson, is in hospice right now. We've been there, we prayed for her, and we're believing right now that your presence will make itself manifested inside of her very body, mind, and spirit. As she cannot speak and talk, she can't always relate to you. Now, God, there are some people here today who are asking for certain kinds of miracles in their life. They're asking for healing, God. And you said to us one of your greatest ministry by way of Jesus was a healing ministry. And I'm believing right now, if there's something in their bodies or in our bodies that we don't even know anything about, I'm praying that you will wipe them away and make us in perfect health. God, I'm praying for those who have gone to the hospital and the doctor said we got to keep watch on you. We're praying that all the things will come out all right. We're believing other people will help in that analysis as well. God, for those who are depressed and going through emotional illnesses and ailment, you touch so many people. And even now, I pray in the name of Jesus that you will touch their mind, pull out those kinds of spirit of depression, spirit of anxiety, spirit of anger, spirit of frustration, a spirit of being retribution, spirit of hate. And I pray that you replace it all of a sudden with love and joy. Thank you, God, for this church. What you did last week in bringing thousands and thousands of people in your presence. Thank you for segmenting us out with the Alzheimer's organization to say we want to participate in the ministry that the church already does. Thank you, God, for the community that came together in thousands of people here on Thursday. We became a witness to the community that the church is still alive and that the church is active in the community and ready to embrace them wherever they are in life. Now, God, let your spirit have its way in this church. In Jesus' name we pray for his sake. Amen. Give God a great big hand praise. Turn to your neighbor and give him a wave and say, neighbor, I am so glad God is able. Amen. Thank you, choir. We're going to have our announcements come at this time, and we pray that you will see and listen to the marvelous works and ministry that your church does every Sunday.
This summer, we're embarking on a mission to make a difference. Join the Mount Zion Hope in the Village crew on Sunday, August 11th, as we head to volunteer at the Cleveland City Mission. For over 20 years, we have been dedicated to serving the city and sharing the love of Jesus. We're seeking enthusiastic individuals who are passionate about serving others and committed to helping feed those in need. If you're ready to make an impact, please call the church office or visit the Connect desk to sign up. Together, we can bring hope and nourishment to our community. Don't miss this incredible opportunity to serve. Attention all women of Mount Zion. We have an extraordinary event planned just for you. Mark your calendars and invite your friends, sorority sisters, family members, and coworkers to the premier Sunday luncheon event in Cleveland, the annual Amazing Women Luncheon. Tickets are just $25 and are known to sell out quickly. Secure your spots today by visiting the Connect desk in the foyer. Don't miss this unforgettable celebration of amazing women. Get ready for a heartwarming journey down memory lane.
Hey, there are opportunities to hang together. Don't forget to join a Connect group. The golf group has another outing in the works. The foodie group is going to meet at a restaurant soon. The bowling group is meeting this month at the bowling alley, and the travel group has 3 trips planned already. August 29th, they are traveling to Hartville and riding the Cuyahoga Valley train. September 12th, they are going on the Lady Caroline cruise. And October 9th to the 10th, meet them at the Ark Encounter and Creation Museum. It's a meetup and you're invited. Head to the Connect desk for further details on how to join in.
Join us on Sunday, August 11th, for a special day we're calling Throwback Sunday. This is no ordinary Sunday. It's a celebration that captures the essence and warmth of yesteryears.
I am a winner.
I am a winner.
Say, I am a boss.
I am a boss.
And say, sometimes I'm a worker.
Sometimes I'm a worker.
What's up, guys? We just wanted to give a big, huge shout-out to Pastor Larry and his team for coming out here and teaching us how to tie these amazing ties that we all got blessed with. And it was a great experience meeting all of them. We look forward to more experiences in the new year.
How's it going, Neo? Just wanted to give a big shout-out to Pastor Larry, giving us a lot of words and wisdom. One thing that he told us to do is go home, grab us a journal, and write down our aspirations and our dreams in it. I'm definitely going to be doing that when I get home. Go to the store, grab me a little notebook, and just wanted to say big thanks to Pastor Larry and his team. There we go.
Thank you, Dr. Macon, for coming out to my school with the dads on duty. My students have not been able to stop ranting about this teens, teachers, and ties event. It's completely raised the moral of the place. I appreciate you so much.
Thank you, Pastor Larry and your team, for coming down here and spreading your wisdom. Honest to God, the affirmations definitely stood out to me, and I'm pretty sure stood out to all these other young men. And I'm taking notes. I don't journalism, and yes, I'm a boss. Thank you.
Lastly, this summer, we want you to do a few things. First, pray for the ministry at the Mount Zion Prayer Garden. Any day of the week, pull up and pray. Also, our church is being used for various school programs, city summer camps, and even senior wellness during the week. Here are just a few of the ministries we do and support the entire year. For 2025, we are releasing a new motto for the church. When someone asks you, "What is Mount Zion about?" we want you to tell them Mount Zion is a place where you will be safe, healthy, healed, and saved. Thank you. And remember, we are Mount Zion.
Amen. Let's give God some praise for all that he's doing here at Mount Zion. I'm going to ask if you would stand on your feet and turn your Bibles to the book of Malachi 3, 6 through 12 as we prepare for the giving time, as we bless God through our giving. How many blessed folk do we have in the house? Say amen. How many givers do we have in the house? Say hallelujah. The Bible says it's more best blessed to give than to receive. There's a direct correlation with your giving when it comes to receiving from God. God wants to know, are you willing to give? And when you're willing to give, God will do what? He'll take care of you. He'll cover you, even in areas where you didn't know that he was covering you. If it had not been for God that was looking out by your side, somebody asked the question, where would I be? How many of you are thankful that God was looking out for you? Just say hallelujah. And so let's go to our text. And again, if you're watching us online, thank you for giving even during this time. And so the Bible says this. The Bible says, "For I am the Lord, I change not. Therefore, ye sons of Jacob are not consumed." And you say? "Will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offerings.
You are cursed with a curse, for ye have robbed me, even this whole nation.
Bring ye all the tithes into the storehouse, that there may be meat in mine house. And prove me down herewith, saith the Lord of hosts, if I will not open you the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing, that there shall not be room enough to receive it.
I rebuke the devourer for your sake. He shall not destroy the fruit of your ground, neither shall your vine cast it from time in the field, saith the Lord of hosts."
Let's read 12 together. "And all nations shall call you blessed, for ye shall be a delightsome land, saith the Lord of hosts." Let us bow our heads in a moment of thanks, thinking unto God, thanking God for all that he's given us, all that he's done in our lives. The Bible says, "I will rebuke the devourer." There are things that are set up to take you out, but I believe that when you are in obedience with God's word, when you're following his ways, I believe that he will rebuke the devourer even on today. So thank God for protecting you. Thank God even for what he did on yesterday, knowing and believing on what God can do on tomorrow. I pray today as you give, know and believe that we have to continue to share the love of Jesus Christ. We have this wonderful church, this wonderful edifice, so that we can share Jesus Christ. Thank the Lord today for this church. Thank him for Mount Zion and this ministry and all that we're able to do, not only for the church community, but even for the greater community. We're able to bring them here and they're able to experience what God has for them, even in this place. We believe that this is holy ground and marvelous and miraculous things happen on holy ground. So as we give today, as we give to God, and as we bless his church and bless his ministry and bless his house, we believe today that God will bless our house even on today. I pray if you're a giver, will you just raise your offering or even raise your hand if you give online or through Givelify or through the Cash App. Just raise your hand in victory even on today as we give, not grudgingly, but we give cheerfully. Somebody say cheerfully. Heavenly Father, we lift you up today. We give cheerfully today, knowing and believing that when we give to you, we not only get back what we give, but we get back more than if we had kept it to ourselves. Father, I pray today that you would bless the giver. Thank you, God, for all that you've been doing, and thank you, God, for all that you're going to do. We trust you, we love you, and we magnify your name. In Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people said, amen, amen and amen. I'm going to ask all of those that are bringing a tithe and offering, you can come right now to the tithe and offering baskets. The song says, "We're blessed in the city, we're blessed in the field."
Let me hear you say, blessed, 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 blessed.
your hands up in the air if you can and say, all things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Everybody in the church, all things.
All things come of thee, O Lord,
and of thine own.
And of thine own
have we.
Have we.
Of God said,
oh,
yeah. Amen. As you remain standing, open up your receptacles even now. There's now no condemnation to those who are in Christ. As the technician placed the communion text up there on the screen in chapter 11 of 1 Corinthians, the 23rd verse, that we all might read together, even though we pray that you carry your Bible. Say, neighbor, you need your Bible, and you need to carry your Bible. There's something about reading the Bible. Billy Graham never would read a text unless he picked up the Bible and read from the Holy Word. We're grateful for all of our staff who are coming now. Amen. Even our friends. Amen. Here's what it says in the 11th chapter of 1 Corinthians. If you can, you can read it with me today as soon as he puts it up there. In 1 Corinthians, Paul was going to say these words. Let's just read it together. Amen. How many of y'all can read? Let me see you say amen. How many of y'all can't read? Say, help me, Jesus. We'll put some pictures up for you during the communion time. Let's read this together, starting at verse 23. You ready? For I have received of the Lord that which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, read it down to the 34th verse, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same, together, after the same manner, okay. Also, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as ye drink it in remembrance. Verse 26, for as often as ye eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death until we come. Wherefore shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily, shall be guilty of the body and blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily, eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world. Wherefore, my brethren, when ye come together, and if any man, eternal God, our Father, we come here. We thank you for giving us the marvelous example of your reading of your text to remind us that, yes, you were crucified on Calvary, that yes, you rose from the grave, and that ultimately you're coming back for us. Remind us, oh God, that we're cleansed by your blood, that we're cleansed by your death, that we're cleansed by your sacrifice. When we were at odds with you by way of our sin, you filled in the gap by way of your death and your life. We thank you, God, for coming down here 33 and a half years and living with humanity, to show us how to be a part of the new colony outside of heaven itself here on earth. And we pray that your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, God, as we participate in this marvelous, marvelous sacrament, in this kind of ritual which remind us that we also have died with you, that we also will rise with you and we will reign with you one day eternally. Thank you, God, for your goodness, your love, and your mercy. The Bible says on the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus was there with his 11 disciples. Judas, having already betrayed him, had left the supper table, but he left too soon. He could have hung around and realized that his sins were being forgiven also. But the Bible says that he wanted to remind them that he was coming back and that he had already paid the supreme penalty for their sins. No more lambs, no more rams, no more turtle doves, no more animal sacrifice, because the supreme sacrifice was made for us in the form of God himself. And so he took the bread, he blessed it, he gave it to them and said, as often as ye do this, as often as you eat this, do it in the remembrance of me. Let us eat together. There on the table, the bread represented his flesh, but the fruit of the vine represented his blood, because mankind's blood was tainted. Our blood is tainted, but ultimately God has taken the taint away from our bloodline. So he has infused us with his blood, and so we can live, move, and have our existence and be healed, because we have the blood of Jesus in essence inside of us. And so he took the fruit of the vine, he blessed it, he gave it to them and said, as often as you drink this, drink it in the remembrance of me, remembering that I'm coming back to save you and to provide for you. Let us drink together. And all the people of God said, amen. And all the people of God said, hallelujah. And all the people of God said, thank you, Jesus. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Let's give God a great big amen. Amen. God bless you as Pastor Larry is coming out.
Amen, amen.
Give us the word.
If you have a Bible on you, turn it to the book of Matthew chapter 9. Matthew chapter 9. If you have a Bible, say amen.
Amen.
If you got a smartphone, say, I got something.
I got a lot.
Matthew 9, 29. If you have a Bible with you, Matthew 9, 29. Great proclamation I'd love for us to proclaim even over our own lives. The Bible says this, and we can put that on the screen. Matthew chapter 9, verse 29. Repeat after me. Say, according to your faith, it will be done to you. Now, I want you to say it like you mean it. Say, according to your faith, it will be done unto you. Now, I want you to talk to your neighbor. Turn to your neighbor. Say, neighbor, oh, neighbor, according to your faith, it will be done unto you. You know, before I go into the sermon portion of this talk, I want to kind of talk about a quick story that will help us as we introduce this text. So there's a story about a few tiny frogs. Somebody say frogs. And these frogs, they arranged a running competition, and the goal was to reach the high tower. They were trying to reach a very high tower, and a big crowd had gathered around the tower to see this race and cheer on this competition, and the race began. And the truth of the matter is that honestly, no one in the crowd really believed that the frogs, these tiny frogs, could reach the top of the tower. And so the observers, they shouted statements such as, no way, it's too difficult, you can't do it, you'll never make it to the top, and no chance that you'll succeed in doing this, and the tower is way too high. And so it was all the people around saying that it was impossible. And sure enough, the tiny frogs, they began collapsing one by one. And except for a few of them who in a fresh temple and spurt of energy was climbing higher and higher of the tower. And so the crowd continued to yell that it was way too difficult and no way they would ever make it all the way to the top. And so more of the tiny frogs began to give up, and most believed that the crowd was probably right and it was very impossible. But there was one tiny little frog that began to jump higher and higher, and this frog refused to give up. And at the end of the race, all of the frogs had given up climbing the tower except for one tiny frog. And after a big effort, the one tiny frog that was the only one that reached the top of the tower, of course, all of the tiny frogs around wanted to know how this one frog managed to do it. And so they asked the tiny frog, "How did you succeed and find the strength to reach the top of the tower?" And so the tiny frog explained with gestures and a smile that the way that he made it to the top of the tower is because he was deaf. He thought the crowd that was yelling had been encouraging him the entire time. You know, sometimes we've got to be like that deaf frog, and we can't let the negative things around us and what people are saying shake our faith. Today I want to talk to you a little bit from the subject of faithing it forward. Somebody say faithing it forward. Sometimes you got to faith it forward. You know, one of the verses that I love in the Bible is Matthew 9:29. To me, it speaks to what I like to call a universal law of life, and that is the law of expectation. The law of expectation. And see, that's what faith really is all about. Can you live by faith when bad news comes your way? Can you walk by faith? Can you walk by it when you've lost something or you've lost someone that is dear to you? Can you lean on it when the doctor says good health is not on your chart? When life happens, can you faith forward? You know, when I recite this verse, the question comes to my mind, what am I expecting God to do? So here in the text, Jesus, in the context of this story surrounding Matthew 9:29, he's healing blind men. He's healing some blind folk, and he's saying this, especially to one of the men. In essence, choose your outcome and choose your destiny. You've got a say in how things are going to turn out. You've got a say in your future. Your belief will determine what happens. And so what we call it the law of expectancy, which is established by God, where we tend to get out of life what we expect out of life. We tend to see what we expect to see. We tend to hear what we expect to hear, law of expectancy. We tend to feel what we expect to feel. We tend to accomplish what we expect that we're going to accomplish. And so Jesus is saying in this text that the direction of your life will determine, the direction of your faith will determine the direction of your life. Now, I don't know who needed to hear this today, and we can put that on the screen. The direction of your faith will determine the direction of your life. Now, I don't know, again, who needed to hear this, but do you have the faith to believe that things are going to get better? I want to ask you the question, do you have the faith to believe that you are, or do you have the faith to believe that God is going to heal you? Do you have the faith to believe that God can turn it around in your home? Do you believe that God can make things better on your job? Faith it forward says, yes, I'm in trouble, but I believe God in the midst of my trouble. I believe God will do what he said he would do. He promised never to leave me. He promised never to forsake me. And I believe that he can bring peace to my troubled storm. Is there anybody in this place that can believe today that God will bring some peace to your troubled storms? See, faith in it forward means this. It means, Lord, I'm going to walk through this thing expecting your miracle working power. I don't know who I'm talking to, but somebody needs to expect the miracle working power of God. Somebody in this place has experienced the miracle working power of God. If God has worked a miracle in your life, you just need to raise your hand so they can see all the witnesses around this building. So that leads me to the pivotal question. How do I get a little more faith in my life? After all, the real question is this: how do I faith forward to better in my life? And not faith it simply backwards. How do I faith forward and not lose my faith? There are things that are set up in this world that try to help us to lose our faith. Well, unfortunately, here's the news. There is no vitamin that you can take. There is no therapy per se. There is no seminar. There is no YouTube to watch. There is no secret sauce to this. The text gives the answer. The Bible says, according to your faith, be it unto you. The Voice version of the text says, according to your faith, it will be done to you. The Message version says, become what you believe. Become what you believe. How do you faith it forward? Faith is built, and here it is, by exercising it. That is the way you have to exercise your faith. Exercising your faith is simply making the right responses to what life throws at your life. Now, I know many of you know that life will test you. How many know life will test you? I don't know about you, but life will put you to the test. Life will throw some things in your direction that will make you lose your mind. Up in here, up in here. Life will make you want to give up. Life will make things happen that don't go as planned. Life will bring some surprises in your direction, and it begins to get hard to trust it. It begins hard to believe in things that you cannot see and believe in things that you cannot feel or you don't really know and understand. But if you want to succeed in life, you gotta have some faith. Yes, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence for things not seen. And see, the good news is faith is like a muscle. When it's stretched and when it's pulled, it develops and it gets stronger. See, your faith from yesterday is what's bringing you to your today. And it's what's going to take you to your tomorrow. Is there anybody in this place that is holding on to your faith from yesterday that's carrying you to your tomorrow? See, James 1 verse 3 says this: the testing of your faith develops what we all need in these days and times. The Bible says it develops perseverance. Somebody say perseverance. And so I'm here to tell you today that what you're going through could be a test in order to help you get a little stronger. So the predicaments that we find ourselves in should be looked at. They should not be looked at as problems, but we should look at them as some faith-building opportunities. See, think of it this way. Yes, I lost this, but this is an opportunity for me to have faith in this other area. Yes, they treated me this way, but this is an opportunity to have faith that I'm going to be okay anyway. Yes, this is what I see in my predicament, but this is an opportunity to build my faith in what God can do in my life. This is an opportunity to see how God is going to turn it around. And see, there's two ways God tests us, and I just want to hit on them real quick today. There's two ways God tests us. He tests us through difficulties, but he also will test us through our economics. You see, challenges, yes, your challenges and your pocketbook is where God generally will hit you. Sometimes God is testing you when you get into debt, but sometimes God is testing you when you get out of debt. God is testing you when you have extra, but God also tests you when you got less than you want. Oftentimes we're being tested when we're going through some financial problems. See, you can't get what you're not willing to give. However, here's another thing. We're also tested with difficulties. See, sometimes God will send us through the furnace of affliction. See, the Bible loves to talk about how we are, in essence, sent through fires in our life. But see, when you go through the fires, fires are meant to refine us. They're meant to shape us. They're meant to mold us, and they're meant to make us better. And the truth is, when you're going through the fire, all the fire is doing is trying to get the impurities out. You know, for instance, when you look at a goldsmith, let me give you an example. When you look at a goldsmith who's making gold and silver, and if you ask them, how do you make some beautiful jewelry? He will tell you that he'll have to burn the impurities away. And if you ask him, how do you know that the impurities are all gone when you're looking at the gold and the silver? He will tell you that the way you know that you got all the impurities out is that you can see your reflection in it. See, what I want to say to you today is that when God sees his reflection in you, that's when he knows that he's got the impurity out of our lives. And that's when you'll pass the test. See, when you walk by faith, when you faith it forward, that's when God can see his reflection in you. He can see you following his word, and he can see you following his ways. So as you go through the test of life, the Bible says, consider it pure joy. Now, how do I do that? James chapter 1, 2, and 3 for my note takers. It says, consider it pure joy when you face trials of many kinds. Because you know that the testing of your faith does what? It develops perseverance. Praise God, it's just an opportunity to exercise your faith. Praise God, it's just an opportunity to lean on not on what's temporary, but to lean on what you know. See, sometimes what you go through is an opportunity for you not to lean on what you see, but sometimes you got to lean on what you know. Is there anybody in this place that had to lean on not what you can see, but lean on what you know? We know that God is with us. We know that God has a plan for us. We know that God has a purpose for our lives. We know that God is going to help us through it. We know that if we made it this far, God is not going to leave us. We know that. That is evidence that he didn't bring us here to leave us alone. No, at the end of the day, we're not necessarily thankful for the problem, but we can still consider it joy. We can still have joy and be thankful in the midst of the problem. See, that's the difference. You can have joy not because of the problem, but you can still have joy in the midst of what you go through. Is there anybody going through a little bit of something and you said, I still have joy? Is there anybody that's been through some trials and said, it did not knock me down? I still have joy. We can be thankful in the midst of the problem. Give God some praise if you're thankful in the midst of it all. God is saying this. Don't stop being who you're supposed to be just because of what you're going through. You're still a child of the Most High God. You should know that trouble won't last always. You should know that this won't be your situation forever, because God supplies the needs of those who have faith. You know, this is what I love. The Bible teaches that God supplies daily bread. Let me give you a nugget. Somebody say daily bread. Not weekly bread, not monthly bread, not even yearly bread. And see, that's not to say that he won't help you on tomorrow. It's just to say God wants you to remember what he did on today. Is there anybody here that can be honest with me in saying that the Lord has brought you through a mighty long way? Is there anybody here that can truly say, I thank you for your daily bread? See, faith is about thanking God for his daily bread. If you've got roof over your head today, you ought to give God some praise for his daily bread. If you've got food on your table today, you ought to give God some praise for your daily bread. If you got a reasonable portion of health and strength, somebody ought to thank God for his daily bread. We're asking about tomorrow, but God is blessing you on today. If you made it here safely today, it's because of his daily bread. Somebody say, I prayed about it, and it may not be here today, but God bless me with my daily bread. While you're waiting, don't forget that God is working it out in your life. Can somebody thank him for his daily bread? Come on, stand with me today. Thank him for your daily bread. Every day, God is doing some miracle working things in your life. Matthew 9, 29. Some blind men, they had recognized who Jesus is and what he's capable of. And so these men in the text in Matthew, they're asking for mercy. They're asking for healing. They're asking to receive their sight. But Jesus wanted to know a question from them. He said, do you really think that I can do it? And what did they say? They said, yes. My question to you, are you willing to say yes? even in the midst of your affliction? Are you willing to say yes, even when you don't know that it's going to happen? Are you willing to say yes? Not just that you believe, but yes, I have faith in your miracle working power in my life. You know, we live in a world of bad news, but the author of good news is in control. The Bible says that he's the author and he's the finisher of our faith. He showed us what faith is all about, and he showed us what faith can do for us. So you've got to put your faith into use at the times when you need it the most. And you've got to faith it. You've got to faith it. You got to faith it till you make it. If you believe his word, give him a praise one more time. Bow your head with me today. Let's just talk to God for a quick moment. I want to talk to someone here today. Maybe you have been dealing with some faith issues. I want to tell you that your faith will take you to the places that you're trying to go. You've got to faith it forward. If you believe the word of God, you've got to remember that it all starts with faith. If you're dealing with some uncertainty of your future, I want you to know that it starts with your faith. Faith and belief also in Jesus Christ. I want to ask the question all around the building. We would be remiss from asking this question. If your heart stopped beating in the next few minutes, are you right with God? Do you have a relationship with Jesus Christ? And if that's you, I want you to say yes. But if you're here today and you haven't been walking by faith and you need Jesus in your life, I want to let you know that this is the opportunity where you can begin to faith it forward. This is the opportunity where you need to know and you need to be secure in knowing that if you were to leave this earth, you would have eternal life. So I want to pray with you today. If there's somebody here today and you want to accept Christ into your life, as every head is bowed, as all the saints in this building are praying for those that may be unchurched or praying for those that may not have had the relationship with Jesus Christ, I want to give you the opportunity to say yes to Jesus. If you're here today and you just want to say yes to Jesus, you've never accepted him into your life, and you just want to say, yes, Lord, I want to begin to follow you even on today, I want you to raise that hand. If you want to say yes to Jesus Christ, maybe you haven't accepted him before, but you want to accept him on today, just raise that hand high if you're here today. And I just want to pray with you if you're in the audience and you want to say yes to the Lord. Yes, Lord, I want to follow your way. Lord, I haven't asked you to come into my heart, but today I want to choose to follow you. If you're here today, just raise that hand high if you're in the building. If your hand is down, I'm assuming that you've already accepted Christ into your life. If you're here today, just raise that hand high, and I want to just bring you in. I want to say a prayer with you. We're also going to say a prayer even together. Everyone here today, I want you to pray this prayer with me. Say, dear Lord, I choose today to follow you. I believe that you died on the cross for my sins and that you rose from the grave on the third day. Come into my heart. Continue to be in my heart and save me right now. I choose today to follow you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you pray that prayer for the first time, I want you to connect with us. There's a card in the pew I want you to fill out or go to the connect desk, and we want to show you the next steps. But we want you to say yes to the Lord even on today. If you're here today and you've got a special prayer request, raise that hand high. Before we go, I want to pray with you, and I believe that God's going to do something in your week. I see hands in there. Heavenly Father, I pray right now for those with a special prayer request. Bless them, God. Help them to know that they can walk by faith and not by sight. Be with them, God. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. And all God's people said, amen and amen. Come on, give God some praise today and consider yourself dismissed. God bless you, and we'll see you on next week. Amen, amen. Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever.